Hello. Good morning. I'm Farah Jasmine Griffin, professor of English and Comparative Literature and African American Studies at Columbia University. Yes. But in this capacity, I am thrilled to be and honored and proud to be one of the members of the organizing committee that brings you Black Girl Movement, a national conference. I'm also very excited to welcome you to the second event, second day of our historic gathering. Last night, how many of you were at Raw Space Gallery last night? All right, yeah, so bring that energy in here. We started last night at Harlem's Raw Space Gallery with an opening of extraordinary, an extraordinary exhibition, which was curated by another one of our team members, Scheherazade Tillett. Is she here? Cher here? Yeah, thank you, Cher. And she was assisted by Zoraida Lopez, who co-curated the show. The show is open throughout the weekend, so I encourage you, if you haven't seen it, to get over to Raw Space to do so. It features Black women and girl photographers. And I can say, quite honestly, that I have never experienced an opening like last night's. Lines down the block, girls outside jumping double dutch, inside dancing to music, DJed by one of their own talented peers, a panel moderated by my brilliant colleague, Kelly Jones. The energy just pulsated through that space out into the street. So I want to thank Cher and Zoraida and the artists and the girls for getting us off to such a powerful start. And I have to say that it was really the heart of our gathering that is going to pulsate throughout our conference. And they got us off with such tremendous joy. So thank you. I wanted to take a few minutes to just share a brief background about the conference, introduce you to the organizers, thank some of our supporters, introduce one of our earliest supporters who will offer greetings, and then turn it over to one of my co-organizers, Cedra Sebastian, who will also give you a little background. Almost 2 years ago, in the wake of President Obama's announcement about the My Brother's Keeper initiative, a small group of us, about four of us actually, met at a place called Radiance Tea House on 50th Street. It's a little Chinese tea house, and they also sell books, because it's like if you like tea and books, it's a great place to go. And we'd known each other as friends, as colleagues, as mentors, but all of us had been working throughout the years on issues of importance to Black women and girls, and we'd been involved in various immediate responses to the president's initiative, most especially a series of important meetings and actions organized by my colleague Kim Crenshaw, who unfortunately is unable to be here with us today. However, at that small gathering, we discussed the challenges girls face, the ways that their concerns and crises are often invisible or dismissed by both our communities and the larger society. And in our public discourse, girls were either invisible or assumed to be so resilient that they were without need of assistance. But we also realized that there were people, scholars, activists, artists, who had been working against this, people who were centering Black girls in their vision for a more just society. And yet, too often, these individuals and groups were working alone in their own communities without resources or without attention for the work they do. So we decided that what was needed was more resources, and more support for those doing the difficult and underappreciated work of supporting Black girls. We also wanted to create a network of practitioners, policymakers, funders, and others. And most importantly, and this is really what's important and central to us, is that we wanted to create a safe space for girls themselves to contribute to building a movement that bears their name while also highlighting their challenges, their crises, and celebrating their brilliance, their creativity, their ingenuity. We need immediate reactions, yes, but we felt we also need a movement. So we left that tea house with a date for our next meeting and names of others that each of us would invite to join. And within a few weeks, we had a committed organizing committee and a plan. Black women with a plan, you know how that goes, right? And at that time, there was still very little national attention being given to girls. Others were working as hard as we were to highlight the urgency, the necessity, the importance of their issues. And since that first set of planning meetings, there seems to have been an explosion of events, programs, initiatives about Black girls. And we say, welcome. Let a thousand flowers bloom. There is so much work to be done, and we need everybody doing it. So I want to take this time to introduce you to my sisters, members of our team, and then to publicly thank our sponsors and our supporters. I'm going to ask members of the conference organizing committee to stand as I introduce them. We start with Camille A. Brown, choreographer, dancer, leader, director of the Camille A. Brown Dance Company. Amy Meredith Cox. Amy is a cultural anthropologist at Fordham University and also a movement artist. Kira Gaunt, pioneering music scholar whose first book on Black girls' games is still changing the way we think about Black girls and their contribution to our culture. Carla Shedd, sociologist, yes, from Columbia University. Cedra Sebastian, yes, who is the associate executive director of the Brotherhood Sister Soul. Joanne Smith, founder and executive director of Girls for Gender Equity. Salamisha Tillett. Salamisha is both professor of English, women, and gender studies at the University of Pennsylvania and founder of A Long Walk Home. And Shahrazad Tillett, who's busy somewhere around, who's co-founder and executive director of A Long Walk Home and an extraordinary photographic artist herself. Let's have a hand for these wonderful women. We've been assisted by Sharon Harris, who is a miracle worker, yes, as well as Sean Mendoza, assistant director of the Institute for African American Studies at Columbia. Zoraida Lopez has also been an important part of our team, and we want to thank April Silver and her team in A Killer Work Songs. We also have a group of very generous sponsors and supporters, including the Columbia University Institute for Research in African American Studies, Columbia University Institute for Research on Women and Gender and Sexuality, Columbia University Office of the President, Dean Alondra Nelson, who's Dean of the Social Sciences Faculty of the School of Arts and Sciences, Fordham University's African American Studies and African Studies programs, the organizations A Long Walk Home, the Brotherhood Sister Soul, Camille Brown and Dancers, Girls for Gender Equity, and foundation funders, the Novo Foundation, tremendous generosity. Just leaders in philanthropy, really showing the way. The Ford Foundation, the New York Women's Foundation, the University of Pennsylvania School of Social Policy and Practice. And I want to say something about one of those very early supporters. One of our earliest supporters and most generous sponsors was and is Columbia University's president, Lee Bollinger. I walked into a meeting with him prepared to launch into a long description of what it was we were doing, and within minutes, before I could even get my second sentence out, President Bollinger offered not only his generous financial support, but his personal support for what was then just a vision and a date on a calendar. So I want to take this opportunity to publicly thank him and to offer him the opportunity to come and offer words of welcome. So President Lee Bollinger.
So it's a great, great pleasure to help fund this and to be part of it. I'm afraid what Farah said says as much about her as it does about the worthiness of this program. Anything Farah wants, I'm prepared to give it to her.
Remember that.
So Farah is one of our most distinguished faculty members, and when I just listened a moment ago, as all of us did, to Farah talking about how she had thought about this and early on just galvanized a group and then welcomed everybody else, I mean, that's exactly what you want at a great university. The only thing I would say is that my life has been shaped by the civil rights movement of the 1950s and 60s. And it was Brown versus Board of Education that was the landmark decision of that period that for somebody like me made me want to go to law school and to be part of a movement from that particular angle. I have since then been a law professor and a university president and been involved in civil rights issues, most notably affirmative action cases in the Supreme Court. And over this time, I have become both very proud of what's been accomplished in the country and at our universities, but deeply disturbed by a sense of a regression that I feel is underway. Yesterday at Columbia, we had Loretta Lynch speak, the Attorney General, of course, of the United States, about problems in the criminal justice system and excessive incarceration. I know a lot, as many people in this room do, about the resegregation of American schools. This is a need, this is a time for another civil rights movement. I'm not sure really what kind of movement it needs to be, but right for its time. And I love the fact that this particular conference, this project, this working with the White House is underway. It's extremely important. I am thrilled and honored to be part of it. Thank you very much, Farah.
Thank you, President Bollinger. I now want to turn the welcome over to my co-organizer, and I should say co-conspirator, Cedra Sebastian, who is the Associate Executive Director at the Brotherhood Sister Soul, a nonprofit organization providing holistic and comprehensive programs for Black and Latino youth ages 8 to 22. Cedra was co-awardee of the Ford Foundation Leadership for a Changing World Award, and she co-authored Taking Back the Work, a cooperative inquiry into the work of leaders of color in movement-building organizations. Cedra is a graduate of Hampton University, and she completed her MA at NYU, focusing on the connections between education, social justice, and the arts. She is currently a Public Voices Fellow of the Op-Ed Project, and education co-chair and steering committee member of New York City's Council's Young Women's Initiative. So, Cedra.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Oh my gosh, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Yes. So inside, there's this thing happening, and I'm trying to keep still. So if I start dancing or stuff start leaking out my eyes, it's because there's so much happening inside. You cannot imagine what it has been like to be in this space for 2 years with these amazing women to create this space for our girls. It has been a joy, it has been a pleasure, it has been a blessing. And I think yesterday, the turn up at the gallery was exactly what was needed to put us in the right space. I think so often when people hear Black girls because we rock and we run and we bike, they think it means former girls, but we are really centering the girls today and tomorrow, and are going to continue to do that. And so we're so excited to see those girls in the space right now, and so excited that you're going to hear from them as well. Farah started talking about what is happening right now. What is happening right now is what we got to see at Picturing Black Girlhood, this phenomenal exhibit, 18 photographers, many of them young women from all across the country who are showing a slice of their experience today. In that moment, in this moment, we are seeing our girls as being present, as being bold, vibrant, pushy, loud, thoughtful, expressive, all these things and more, right? So one thing yesterday that stood out for me at the exhibit, and I really encourage you all to check it out because it is amazing. This one young woman is so excited, and her mom comes in, and her friend comes in, and her cousin comes in, and an uncle comes in, and she has this tribe of people who are with her, and she's like, that's mine. And that was just so powerful to see. And I ask you all to think, how are we creating spaces for girls to say, this is mine, I belong here, this is me? And that's what we hope that the conference will be able to do. I was reminded also that those girls in the space were not just having a good time to the DJ that was helping with the turn up, but they are very much awakened by all the things that are happening and activating other girls as well. There was a chant for Rakia Boyd, say her name, Rakia Boyd. Say her name, Rakia Boyd. Yeah, like that's what they were doing in that space as well. They were chalking the ground and marking their territory because it's theirs and it's always been theirs, right? And so today we're going to be hearing from researchers, lovers of Black girls, people who have been doing the work for a long time, people who are just coming to the work, but our girls have always been here and have always been present. And they will be taking space at the table as well. what else is happening right now in this moment of Black girls, girls of color, cisgender, trans girls, queer, immigrant, and undocumented, right? What is happening right now? So on a national level, we know less than a few weeks ago, there was an announcement by three congressional representatives, Bonnie Watson Coleman, Robin Kelly, and Yvette Clark from New York, New Jersey, and Illinois, saying we need to create a congressional space that is focused on what is happening in the lives of Black girls and Black women. And so they say to us, the Congressional Caucus on Black Women and Girls gives Black women and girls a seat at the table for the crucial decision on the policies that impact them while also providing a framework for creating opportunities and eliminating barriers to success for Black women and girls. Congressional level. That is amazing, right? We want to talk about monies. One of our amazing co-sponsors also made a great announcement just a couple of weeks ago, something about that March fever, right? The Novo Foundation announced a $90 million commitment to Black girls and girls of color to center them, to have them take the lead, to listen to them so that they have a say in how that money is spent, right? To support research who have been doing this work, to support activists and artists and educators who have been uplifting girls and who want to continue to do that work. And then on a very local level, welcome to Harlem, people. Yeah. Welcome to New York City. I know we have people literally from across the country who are here, but right now in New York City, I get to join Joanne, who's one of the co-chairs of this amazing commission. We are saying we need to figure out how we make New York City a better city for Black girls and girls of color. What can we do, right? And not only have we asked this question, right, of adults, we have created a space for girls to tell us what to do. So there are 25 young women who since the summer have been advising this committee on what they want, what policies need to be shifted in education, in health access, their post-secondary experiences, what those things should look like. We are grooming not only the next mayor of New York City, we are grooming the next president, we are of universities, of countries, all around the world. That is what we are preparing. We are preparing the next poet laureates of the country. We are preparing physicians. We are preparing the astronauts. We are preparing the lovers and the providers that are going to continue to hold up more than half the sky. That is what is happening right now in this moment of Black girlhood. I also want to thank you. I told you it's happening inside. It's going. I want for you to take a moment to look around, right? We have three sections of people. We have people who are watching via live stream. Look around. This is who has decided to show up for Black girls, right? And it's been an overflow. Like, this could be out on Columbia's campus. That's how many people are emailing and still emailing right now to try to have space here. But we're so glad that you came and that you are here. We encourage you to be present. If you see a Black girl, give her a hug, give her a high five, give her some love, show her some energy. Listen to what our girls are saying to us and follow their lead because they are leaders right now. So thank you again for your presence. We are standing on amazing ground. We have an amazing panelist to take over this morning throughout the day today and also tomorrow, which I'm really excited about. So I hope that you will be with us on tomorrow as well. And again, Picturing Black Girlhood is still open today and tomorrow at Ross Space in Harlem on Adam Clayton Powell Boulevard between 121st and 122nd Street. So thank you again for your attendance, for your focus, for your presence, and I ask you to take on the charges that the panelists will be giving you throughout the conference. Thank you so much.
Housekeeping points for you. There should be some clarification. The Wi-Fi is under missed guests, and the password is get on, and is it an L? One. Get on one. No. line. Okay. Okay, I'm going to start this over. You have to use caps. It says get online, but the online, the I in line, is a number one. Got it? So it's get O-N-L, number one, N-E. All caps. No, no, G. Capital G, E T, capital O N L 1 N E. You all who were there yesterday could probably make some kind of fierce chant out of that or something, but capital G E, capital G, lowercase E T, capital O, lowercase N, lowercase L, the number one, N E. Okay? And then there's some other points of information. At Twitter, we're at Black Girl Movement, but movement is MVMT, MVMT. And it's hashtag Black Girl Movement, hashtag BGM 2016. Please use your social media to talk about what's going on, to share information about the panels and what you're experiencing here today. So I'm now going to ask our panels, for our first panelist to come up and join us here on stage. And I will introduce our moderator for that panel, and she will introduce the panelists themselves. Panelists, want to come up? The first panel? Mm-hmm. Okay, so our first panel is going to be moderated by Dr. Salamisha Tillett. Dr. Tillett is an associate professor of English and Africana Studies and has a faculty appointment in gender, sexuality, and women's studies at the University of Pennsylvania. She is a regular contributor to the New York Times Arts and Leisure section. She has also published in the Chicago Tribune, The Guardian, The Nation, and The Root. She appeared, some of you may recognize her because she's appeared on BBC, CNN, and most often on MSNBC. She is the author of Sites of Slavery, Citizenship, and Racial Democracy in the Post-Civil Rights Imagination. And she is currently working on Nina Simone's protest anthem, Mississippi Goddamn. Yes, in the tradition. Salamisha and her sister, Shahrazad Tillett, are the co-founders of A Long Walk Home, one of our co-sponsoring organizations, which is a nonprofit that uses arts to educate and empower young people to end violence against all girls and women. So I'm going to turn our panel over to Salamisha, and she will take it from there. Thank you.
I'm Salamisha, and I am just so honored and blessed to be in this space on this day with you wonderful people. I would like to just say that I never do anything early, so this panel is beginning early, which is great. And I just want to thank all of our funders and all of our sponsors and organizations that are working in this coalition. I just want to say, I want to thank Farrah Griffin. I had the honor of being an undergraduate student of Professor Griffin's when she was at Penn. And so I always say that Farrah has created a blueprint for the kind of activist and writer and scholar that I've become. But it was lovely just to be able to do this with you. So thank you so much. To my fellow conference organizers, Kira, Camille, Amy, Joanne, Cedra, Shahrazad, and Carla. I looked at Carla. Thank you so much for helping create this other baby of mine a reality. Okay, so and my fellow panelists, and also just a shout out to Pamela Schiffman, who has been so committed to this work and is as a funder, but as a friend and an activist, just a constant source of inspiration and friendship and a leader in this movement. Okay, so I'd like to frame this conversation by invoking the names and contributions of two African-American girls. The first is Barbara Rose John, who on April 23rd, 1951, at the age of 16, led a student strike for equal education at her segregated school in Farmville, Virginia. After securing NAACP legal support, the students from this school, the Moton High School, filed Davis v. Prince Edward County, the largest and only student-initiated case consolidated in the landmark school desegregation case, Brown v. Board of Education. As Davis, this case was the only one in which that got subsumed under Brown that was initiated by a student protest. Many understand this moment as led by the teenage black girl, Barbara Rose John, as the beginning of the civil rights movement itself. The second person I would like to dedicate this panel to is Nia Kenny. Is she here, Nia? Mm-hmm. She was there last night. Okay, so she's here in spirit and she's at this conference. Whose video of her classmate, a 16-year-old girl, African-American, a 16-year-old African-American girl who was flipped on the floor and flung across the classroom by a white school safety officer at Springvale Valley High School in Columbia, South Carolina, went viral last fall. As we know, both girls were subsequently arrested and suspended after this incident, but I'm honored to say that Kenny and her mother have joined us in this gathering and are with us in spirit and eventually, I'm sure, in person later today. So just I want to shout out these two figures and say that this panel is inspired and in honor of them. Okay, so I'm going to introduce this esteemed panel in order of how I'll begin my first question. It's not necessarily in the order of how they're sitting. So when we were imagining a panel and we were thinking about the role of academic research and political organizing, the first name that popped to our heads was Dr. Joyce Ladner, who is a sociologist, civil rights activist, and author. Her pioneering work, Tomorrow's Tomorrow, The Black Woman, was the first major sociological study of adolescent black girls, in which she focused on black girls living in the St. Louis Pruitt-Igoe housing project from the period of 1964 to 1968. And this book was her dissertation then was published as a book in 1971. Ladner first joined the faculty at Howard University in 1973. A lot of Howard, yes.
71.
Oh, okay, sorry. Sometimes bios get wrong. 71, so right when the book came out in 71. And in 1994, you were interim president of Howard, and she was the first woman to hold that position at the university. She went to Tougaloo College in Tougaloo, Mississippi, where she earned her BA in sociology. and then at Washington University in St. Louis, where she earned her PhD. During college, Ladner and her sister Dory organized civil rights protests alongside Medgar Evers and other students from the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, SNCC. Michaela Gilliam Price is a 17-year-old Baltimore activist, and she's at the end of the panel. She founded... And so just for Michaela, this is like a, there's a fabulous feature on her in the Washington Post, and I was like, we have to get her here. Okay, so she founded the youth organization City Block and also the website Asada Syllabus. She organizes with leaders of a, Asada, with leaders of A Beautiful Struggle, a youth-led grassroots think tank which advances public policy in the interests of black people in Baltimore. She was the 2015 recipient of the Princeton Prize in Race Relations Certificate of Accomplishments and the Wired Up Community Hero Award for Outstanding Accomplishments in Youth-Led Leadership. And she's at the forefront of the Black Lives Matter Baltimore movement. Thank you. Another person who we were just excited to have on this panel and came highly recommended from co-organizer Joanne Smith is Daniela Carter. And she is an advocate for LGBT youth and the founder of Gender Global. She's an activist around gender issues and the needs of homeless youth, including working with the organization, which she currently works with, Start From Here. She appeared in Laverne Cox's documentary, The T Word. And last year, she was recognized as part of the 2015 Trans 100 list and attended the White House's annual Emerging Leaders Day, which highlights 100 black leaders. And last but not least is Monique Morris, and she's the author. She's an author and a social justice scholar with more than 20 years of professional and volunteer experience. in the areas of education, civil rights, juvenile, and social justice. Dr. Morris is the author of many books, including the recently published Push Out, The Criminalization of Black Girls in the Schools, which was released last week by the New Press, in which she writes about straight, queer, and transgendered girls from San Francisco, Southern California, Chicago, New York, New Orleans, and Boston. She is also the president and CEO and co-founder of the National Black Women's Justice Institute, an organization that works to interrupt school-to-confinement pathways for girls, reduce the barriers to employment for formerly incarcerated women, and increase the capacity of organizations working to reduce sexual assault and domestic violence in African-American communities. Thank you. Okay, so the panel title is The Past, Present, and Future of Black Girls. And so I wanted to begin the conversation with you, Professor Ladner, and talk about Tomorrow's Tomorrow and the impact it had and your thinking behind publishing the book and doing the dissertation research. And so I listened to an interview in which you recently said that you did this dissertation research with girls that were not so much younger than you at the time.
Right.
And in that book, which you carefully show the ways in which Black families and Black girls do not fit into stereotypes and do not fit into the language of pathology, which was obviously very dominant post the kind of Moynihan report in many ways. There's a wonderful line in this book, and I want you to just kind of unpack it a little bit for us, because it just stood out to me as part of the work that we're doing here. So the sentence is, the total misrepresentation of the Black community and the various myths which surround it can be seen in microcosm in the Black female adolescent.
Good morning. Especially to all of you beautiful girls. It's hard to see you, but I know you are. I want to thank Farah and all of the other distinguished members of this planning committee. You've done a fantastic job. To Professor Dr. Bollinger, President Bollinger, for support. And 50 years, I started my research 51 years ago. I was very young. I had just moved to Washington University of St. Louis in 1964 I was 20 years old, from Hattiesburg, Mississippi. But I had gone to Tougaloo College and had been deeply, deeply involved in the civil rights movement. I was had been kicked out of college, one college, and then went to another for organizing a civil rights demonstration. And the president of the college was under the complete control of the Governor Ross Barnett and other segregationists, came out to our demonstration that night and took my roommate by the shoulder like this and knocked her on the ground. I mean, he was berserk because he had lost control. And that's had a lot to do with what happened in my subsequent life. But by the time I got to grad school, I had a research assistantship that the sociology and anthropology department had gotten from the federal government, National Institute of Mental Health, to study social problems in public housing, because Pruitt-Igoe Housing Project, much like a lot of big city housing projects, had been conceived to be a model place for people who really needed housing to live. And then by the time the city government began was putting only single mothers and children into the project, and then holding back services, it began to disintegrate rapidly. So our job was to find out what was really going on. My advisor, Lee Rainwater, sociologist, asked me, what do you want to study? Because it was wide open. We did ethnographic research where we go out and interview people, spend a lot of time observing them and so on. And I just looked at him like, I guess I wanted to study girls because I am a woman. And he said, fine. And I immersed myself in the lives of these girls from 64 to 68, got to know them very well, spent time with them you know, in every conceivable venue. And what I began to, my advisor was one of the leading proponents of the idea that the black family was pathological, that it was disorganized and so on. And I knew that that was not my family, nor was it the families I was observing. What I was observing were people who, under incredibly difficult conditions, were surviving, and in some cases thriving. With very, very scarce resources, they were struggling against a system, for example, a welfare system. They were on welfare. There was a no-knock rule by the welfare department, which meant that a social worker could knock on your door anytime in a 24-hour cycle. And they frequently would go to the home of women at midnight, after everybody's gone to bed. They'd go in looking for the man in the house, because the rule was that in order to get welfare, the man had to abandon his family and leave. So that was the systematic destruction of families. And if a man was found in the house, then she was thrown off welfare. And it was just also for my teen girls, there was a Planned Parenthood office just across the street, a clinic across the street. The only way they could get contraceptives was to either have had a child. Once you have a baby, then they would give you contraception, but not preventable. Or have your mother and father or father bring you to the clinic. Now, which girl, who was going to do that? Mom to take me to the clinic. So that was another way in which these girls were, the circumstances mitigated against them thriving. But what I found was that they had very strong identities. All of them, except two maybe, one or two, their role models were their moms and grandmothers, the strong women in their families. And to wrap it up, what I saw was strength against incredible odds and women trying their best to survive.
Thank you. So, Michaela, there was an article published on you and your family last year in The Nation, and it quoted Mike Stark, who ran the Maryland's campaign to end the death penalty in 1998, and he said, sometimes in over 20 years of struggle against the death penalty and mass incarceration, you don't always see and feel the tangible, visible results of struggle. And Michaela, I saw a living, breathing representation of the continuity in the struggle for justice. I marched with her when she was not even a toddler, and to see her now, to see that her family has not only given up, but is pushing forward, it's overwhelming. So, in the words of Joyce's generation, you'd be seen as a movement baby who's grown up. So I would like you to talk a little bit about coming of age in this moment with Black Lives Matter. Sparked in some ways in Baltimore, in many ways, by the murder of Freddie Gray, and what it means to be a young leader, a black girl leader, at the forefront of Black Lives Matter now.
Absolutely. And so I think I love that article so much because it's so much about my family.
Yeah.
And like the legacy that brought me here, and like it's very Sankofa oriented and about how this is very full circle, and how I would not be where I am in organizing without my family. And the story of my uncle is such a poignant one, and I think it has so much to do with what my reality is right now. And so my uncle Tyrone Gilliam was executed for a crime he didn't commit the same year that I was born, actually 7 months after my birth. And that was a 10-year-long struggle for my family, which means that my mother, who was in the second row, while she was 9 months pregnant with me, was marching in the streets. She always tells me that like my first lullabies were protest chants. And I, like, some of my very first baby pictures are like of me in my father's arms with signs to abolish the death penalty behind him. And so I always bring up that legacy just because it makes me who I am right now. And I think, though, our generation of movement babies were so dangerous because of the legacy that came before us. And I think, so when I think of organizing in Baltimore, I loved April so much. April was like the uprising within Baltimore because I felt like so many black kids became superheroes in that month. Kids that we had never seen in the streets, kids who were never empowered to organize, were once again reclaiming their cities, reclaiming their communities, reclaiming their voices, and just images that are evoked when I think of like what it means to be a young Black girl organizing in Baltimore. I think of three different images. I think of one time when we were protesting after, immediately after Freddie Gray's death. We were marching along Baltimore Street, which if you're from Baltimore, is there any Baltimore, are there Baltimore people? Hey! Baltimore Street, which is like the strip in Baltimore. And there was a stripper who ran out of the club with fishnets. Her fishnets were torn. She had dollars still pasted under her fishnets. And she jumped on top of a protest vehicle and started chanting with us. And then another image is the image of a little girl. We were at Penn North, the intersection of Penn North, which is right down the street from Freddie Gray's community. And one of it was like a drop top car, and this little girl, she was like 3 years old with two puffballs on her head, was standing up in the middle of her daddy's car while Lil Boosie was like blasting out of somebody's car. And she's standing there with her Black Power fist in the air. And then the third image is when we're walking down one of the main streets in downtown Baltimore, and it's surrounded by whiteness and white money. It's very neoliberal. And me and a few other girls that I just met at that protest were just standing in the middle of the intersection twerking. And I think like those three images show how in Baltimore, Black women and Black girls have been reclaiming their femininity, have been reclaiming and making spaces for themselves, creating transient zones of freedom for themselves, inserting their sexuality, inserting their intersectional identities, inserting their fluidity, and creating spaces for ourselves to be embraced. And that's what being a movement baby looks like for me in Baltimore. It's just a way to reclaim my identity.
Thank you. A lot has been made of Black Lives Matter, rightfully so, being a movement led by Black queer women, by trans men, Black queer women and Black trans men and women. And it's a different model than we inherited in some ways from the civil rights movement, even though those figures were always present. But Danielle, you've been doing work around LGBTQ issues for a very long time, before Black Lives Matter in some ways has centered these individuals and this community. And so I was able to watch your riveting TED Talk. It was so moving, so everyone should check it out. And you tell the story of coming out as a transgendered girl to your conservative Christian foster parents and essentially being kicked out of the house as a result. You were living on subways, and yet you were so defiant that you were able to go to school every day despite, you know, the harshness and tragedy of the situation. So there are two things that stood out to me, both in an interview that I read and then in your TED Talk. One, you said something quite poignant, I think. Getting ready for school the night before for homeless youth, for homeless trans youth, looks different than it does for the average youth. Mm-hmm. And I would like you to talk a little bit about what that means, and not just what it means for you, but what some of us, the privilege that some of us can have as an everyday experience looks different in a society that's not open. And the second thing that you said, and you end your TED Talk with this, a demand, a mandate, you asked the audience to join the revolution in loving someone different, because different is the new frontier. And so I would like you to just unpack that a little. And what is these two quotes, these two concepts, that these two things that you said, how does that help us to imagine a kind of radical vision of Black girlhood? And how does that connect to your work around homeless issues, homeless youth issues, and really a broader democratic world for us all?
So I guess it was at like age 14 when I had to engage in survival sex work to live, and I met so many older trans women and so many cis women who were surviving just like me. And it was that moment, I guess, it was that spiritual awakening where I'm standing on the corner. I said to myself, this is not who I am. And I felt like I didn't belong, all while feeling accepted and loved by people in a way that I never felt before. And so I remember one of my friends always telling me, like, what's the point of going to school? You're nothing but a trainee, and that's all we'll ever be. And I said to her, well, I know this much. I'm not who you say I am. I am who I say I am. And so I knew at that time the only thing I had in terms of a tangible tool and resource was school. Because I say my education is my freedom, and my pain is my truth. And that's what I've lived by since the age of 14. And then as I started to get, I guess, more involved with the work, I realized that there really wasn't a face to the trans struggle, right? Like, we had these media stereotypes of, like, oh, if you're black and you're trans and you have, like, a talent, you can make it in life. But they were missing the fact that so many of these girls don't have the access to even go to acting schools, let alone even finish college. And so I said, if I can become, I guess what I like to say is that freedom tool, to show these girls that we can start on a corner, but we can, I guess, end in a classroom, was something that I really said to myself, I want to be dedicated to doing. And so to me, I felt like, oh, you don't have that much to offer, I guess. So I said, like, what can you do to add to the movement? And so, as I said in a TED Talk, in a transformative moment after being raped for the second time on the street in New York, I was kind of at this place of emptiness. And so I turned to my friend and I said, at that time, Jana Mock was just coming out, and I said, I'm going to meet her. I'm going to meet Jana Mock because this is the first time I see a reflection of my identity in a space where I feel I belong. And that's in media. And so, of course, that's when my friend said, yeah, girl, good luck with that. We'll see you when you get in contact. And so I just kept emailing her. And then about 2 weeks after that, she responded to me and said, hey, you know, I love how much passion you have to really get in contact with me. And I'm like, how passionate you are to get in contact with me. And I'm like, yeah, because I have nothing at this point, right? And the only thing I want from you is education. And she said to me that, you know, that's the most powerful thing I've ever heard a young person say to me, that they don't want the fame, they don't want the glam, they want the education. And so I ended up going to, like, her book signing party, and I just had a conversation with Laverne. And I said, you know, Laverne, like, we don't have the reality that you have. And I think one of us needs to go out there and really start talking about the reality that most of us are experiencing out here. Because when the cameras are off, most of us are still surviving. And she said, you know, like, I've never heard a young person, I guess, articulate in the way you did. And so I think we can start working on a project. And so after I got the T word and started getting connected to Laverne and them, I felt like I had arrived and I was making it and I was thriving. But then every time I went back into my community where I was from, I saw how my sisters were suffering. And then they felt as if it was this separatism thing going on where I felt as if I was better than them. And I said, how can I be better than you when I look just like you? And for me, I learned that now I must live by not only, I guess, love and compassion, but also be mindful how so many people have a lot of misunderstanding of who I am. And so I like that misunderstanding. I like that vulnerability. Like, I like showing up in spaces where people don't think I belong, but I show them where I do belong. Mm-hmm. Meaning, like, my friends will say something's too white or something's not black enough, and I say, well, it's just enough for me because my identity hasn't been present here in the way I'm going to make sure I represent it. Mm-hmm. And so I think that's what I always try to remind youth is that where people say you don't belong, make sure you're present. Mm-hmm. Because your identity and who you are is valuable in spaces where you don't think they are.
I should say that clapping or snapping are both equally accepted here. Snapping. Maybe we should just do snapping. The young people.
And then the difference, the new frontier part, I guess. I said that I want people to join a revolution of loving and accepting someone different because I feel like not one person in this room can look, I guess, to the side of them and say that person looks like them outside of their race. Right, and so we're all different in our own unique ways. And then I guess to me it was coming from the Kimberlé Crenshaw theory, intersectionality, how we are all very unique and different in our own ways, but we have to get to a narrative where it's not just saying that my life matters because I'm black or because I'm trans or because you're a cis woman. It's simply, I'm different, you're different, now get the hell over it and accept me and love me, and that's all you need to do. And the pathways that I choose to create moving forward is my choice, right? Like, I don't have to be an academic. I don't have to be an artist. What if I just want to be human and live in that skin? Because that's who I am. And so I try to remind people, like, join that revolution of loving someone who's different because you're different. And don't you want love and acceptance?
So as Daniela just talked about being school, being a safe space for Monique, in your book, Push Out, and in the recent NPR interview you did, you talked about, you know, the problems, the criminalization that black girls experience within schools. And so I'm going to quote you from your interview. "When I was researching the book, the girls were repeatedly saying, 'If you just put me out of school, that doesn't solve the problem. There are places where we're going to be asking our children to learn. If we want them to be safe, we have to find ways for them to reconcile their conflicts.' This is a central theme of your book, the relationship between schools, safety, black girlhood, and the push-out or the pipeline that you masterfully describe in your book. So if you could just talk a little bit more about, you know, why did you take on this topic? How did the girls within your research and in your book and in the interviews that you conducted, how did they theorize and think about why they are targeted disproportionately for push-out? And is it all black girls, or all there, is there, in a way, a hierarchy of who's more marginal within black girlhood?
Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning.
I have to start by just saying how proud I am to be an alum of Columbia at this moment. And I also consider myself an alum of the Institute for Research in African American Studies as one of the first staff in this space. So I'm really just proud to be on this in this discussion with this amazing panel. You know, several of the comments that were already made, I think, uplift and provide a foundation for me to engage your questions. Mm-hmm. And you know, the point of writing Push Out was to bring life to some of the statistics that have been shared publicly but not thoroughly interrogated, and to really uplift the voices and center the voices of girls who are experiencing a different educational path and trajectory than many of us, even in this room, and especially those of us who have managed to graduate with multiple degrees and have the privilege of engaging in conversations with policymakers and others on their behalf. And so what I wanted to do was really explore and center the voices of girls who are the most marginalized in our communities. Girls who have been commercially sexually exploited, girls who have been raped, girls who have been considered sassy and loud and therefore removed from classrooms, girls who have had their femininity demeaned and disregarded by not just the educators and other caring or other adults in their lives, but by civil rights leaders, by pastors, by people they trust, by their parents. And so, you know, I think what's important in this discussion about school push-out was a recognition that for many girls, particularly black girls, it's not just about a pipeline scenario. It's not just about the incidents that take place in schools that lead to a direct citation and or arrest, although black girls are disproportionately impacted by those as well. It's also by looking at the multiple pathways that lead black girls into contact with the criminal and juvenile legal systems. It's about girls who have been placed out of schools or have felt unsafe in their schools and then pushed out to an extent, to the extent to where they're now engaging in underground economies that place them at risk of other forms of harm beyond contact with the criminal legal system, but certainly that. And so, you know, ultimately what this is about and why I centered this question of education in this work is because I understand from years of engaging on the other side, working around criminal and juvenile justice work, that education is a critical protective factor for black girls against contact with the criminal and juvenile legal systems. One of the things Daniela said about her education, right? My education is my freedom. This is freedom work. I had the privilege of starting this conversation about Push Out with Angela Davis in San Francisco, and that's one of the things that she said. She uplifted. She said, you know, we were in the business of engaging in freedom work, and then we settled for civil rights, you know? And so for me, this is about a return to the freedom work, right? This is a return to our ability to say we can have our education. And when I talk to the girls about what's most important, every girl that I spoke with, every girl, all those girls in juvenile detention facilities, all those girls who we tend to throw away, all those girls that we tend to forget, all of them said, my education is important. Now, they didn't necessarily know how to get there. They didn't necessarily feel that schools understood that about them. But they all felt my education is a critical protective factor. I know I need education. I just don't know how I'm going to get there safely and how I'm going to get through this. And when we talk about the hierarchy, right, are there girls who are most at risk? Every black girl has experienced historical trauma. Every black girl is engaged in an unspoken discussion, negotiation of her power that is deeply historically rooted in the legacies of multiple oppressions that they live with each day. And when we look at the girls, even those who are high performers, who are, you know, those that we tend to say are doing fine, we still see high rates of victimization. We still see a particular risk for them to have to fight, to struggle for their education and for their intelligence and their critical thinking to be accepted as normal. And so I think, you know, I don't place a hierarchy on oppressions, right? Audre Lorde said, don't do that. That's not right, right? At the same time, you know, our communities respond to girls who present along the sort of white middle class framework of femininity. We tend to engage with those girls as if they're okay. And those who step outside of that rubric are not okay, right? And so largely what I think we're engaged in when we talk about schools, when we talk about policies and practices, we're talking about dress codes, we're talking about how we understand willful defiance, we're talking about how we understand what's eligible for suspensions and expulsions. We are talking about these manifestations and presentations of black girlhood in ways that render girls vulnerable. Almost all the girls who ultimately end up in contact with the juvenile legal system have a history of abuse and victimization. And so, you know, ultimately those girls are the ones that are at the highest risk of receiving exclusionary discipline, the suspensions, the expulsions. But again, when we look across the board, even at the girls who were never suspended, if you talk to them about their process, you'll see that it has not been an easy road for them.
So I'm going to keep this theme of risk, and then we'll get to reward alive for a minute. And so, you know, to do, my sister always talks about to do work with black girls is like the hardest work she's ever done, not because the girls are so hard, but to do work on black girls means you have to both educate so many different potential partners and coalition or people or organizations that could be part of your coalition. And at the same moment, you have to change so many different institutions and ecosystems, right? Because to center black girls, in a different way, the quote that you I quoted from you earlier, to center black girls is to change so many layers of our society, families, schools, the prison system, but also just kind of general policy, the city, the country, et cetera. So it's also risky work, right? And it's not work that's easily, you're not given credit for black women who do this work. It's seen as something as just a natural extension of ourselves. And it's not sexy work, yet to become sexy work. And so I want you all to talk about some of the risks, whether it's personal or professional, that you've had to face to do work on black girlhood, to do work on black girls, and some of the stigmas and barriers that you think that people associate with black girls, and have you had to push back against those today? So it could be about, you know, doing research with an advisor, helping people redefine what black girlhood is, facing various systems of abuse, whether it's police officers, whether you're protesting. So just what are the risks that you feel like activists who do work, artists and academics who do work on black girls face? You can give us some examples in your own work. And then how have you kind of worked through that as a model for all of us in the room today? Anyone can jump in.
I was shot with a BB gun once. Seriously. I was with a group of girls in this housing project, and they had begun to walk away. They were walking away from me, and all of a sudden I felt something hit me in the neck, and I screamed because it did hurt. And the girls ran back toward me, and they said, "You just got shot." And I said, no, there's no blood. They said, but it was a BB gun. And they turned around and they saw a guy way over there who had done so. I think this is just an anecdote because I don't think it was that typical. But it was typical in some ways because, you know, if we think about the diminished value of women in the society, the diminished value of poor women, then the diminished value of girls. In a reductionist sense, you can see that girls are at the bottom of the heap. Most of the years since I finished my research in 1968, I've volunteered, been on the board of Planned Parenthood, done volunteer work with adolescent girls in schools around identity issues, and so on. It doesn't matter that the entire waterfront is littered with so many ways in which our girls can be victimized, whether by a boyfriend, a mother's boyfriend, by the pastor in the church who gives opportunities to young men to become leaders and the girls are ignored, to a society that sees our girls as unworthy. And I think that what bothers me most, or pains me most, is that in many ways conditions have worsened since I did my research. Because there are so many more ways in which girls can get caught up either in the criminal justice system, in ways in which you describe like girls being raped, or whatever. A lack of an opportunity structure for the most part, with which to achieve goals. Like, how do you get into school? Mm-hmm. How do you get the education? I found the same thing back in the 60s. If I asked girls what do they want to become, they would tell me, and it was always, I want to get an education so that I can become whatever. Except for one girl who wanted to be the second Aretha Franklin. But the lack of an opportunity structure, I think, is the most critical thing.
I think it is important to uplift the level of risk that we do engage. I think most of us dismiss it because it's sort of par for the course, right? We're like, you know, they're haters, right? Okay, hate, I'm going to continue. I get a lot of hate mail. And unfortunately, the hate mail comes mostly, and I really hate to articulate this, from Black men.
Yeah.
But I have to be honest in this space, sure, because there's some work that we have to do internally. And there's a misunderstanding and a misrepresentation of this work to the extent that many see the work that we engage in and the activism that we do on behalf of Black girls as somehow being anti-Black men, mm-hmm, and boys. Yeah. And we have to challenge that and examine, number one, where it's coming from. But understand that our work is not, that this work is not mutually exclusive, right? This, yeah, is not about a zero sum, you know, because we center Black girls, we can no longer engage in the work of Black boys, right? Or that the Black boys' work happens to the exclusion of Black girls. Right. That we are engaged in what ultimately is about community building. And I've long said, you know, our children are sharing homes, communities, schools, relationships, and, you know, our work is really not about it's not about vilifying men and boys, but it is about calling out when they behave in oppressive ways that harm our girls. And it is about developing systems of accountability to respond to these conditions. And so that's hard work. And the risk is that you end up being, you know, sent hate mail and called names. But, you know, we have work to do. This is where you engage in the healing. You cannot engage in healing unless you confront what the issue is.
And then just building off of that, I think the really important piece is that intraracial violence. And I think that it's not so much so that Black men sincerely want to hate and, yeah, demean Black women, but so much of the intraracial violence that Black girls are facing on the daily basis is as a result of the racial and anti-Black violence has been projected onto our communities and has then been internalized by Black men and then projected onto their Black girls. And so I think that that's an extremely important piece. And I think a very concrete example of that is how Black men's deaths are so valued in our society, right? And that's obviously in a very problematic way because we've been making spectacles out of Black men's death. We've been making commodities out of Black men's death. People, one of my mentors at home calls them poverty pimps, who are profiting off of the back of Black struggle, specifically the struggle of Black men. But then that is internalized within our community. And so when Black men see that only their deaths are being valued, only they can put value on their lives, and not the lives of Black women, that's and right. definitely not the deaths
that's
of Black
right.
women.
That's right.
And an anecdote that one of my mentors always shares with me, and this is, of course, not to create a hierarchy of oppression, but I think it's a visual image that evokes a lot of critical thought, and I hope that it resonates with you all. She says that Black men during slavery were lynched in public while his sister, his mother, his aunt was raped in the shed behind. And so it's like the invisibility of our struggle contributes so heavily to the invisibility of our suffering by ourselves. And I think when Angela Davis spoke at Johns Hopkins University in Baltimore just a few months ago, she spoke about the collateral damage that Black girls and Black women face. And so yes, even if it is true that Black men face a very physical and tangible violence on the daily basis, and that is not to say that Black women do not, on top of us and our physical damage and our physical violence and tangible violence that we face every day, we are also facing the collateral damage left over from the violence that is pitted against our Black men. And that's why I find it so interesting that people are not able to conceptualize the fact that a womanist movement is a movement for our community.
That's right. That's right.
Because in fighting for myself, in fighting for myself, I'm also fighting for the lives of Black men, Black children, and Black people within our community at large. And I think within an academic sense, even though I'm not at the level of you all yet, just in high school. I think what
well
is so
on your
interesting,
way.
Hopefully. I think what's so interesting is that Black women are just delegitimized on every front, including within the academy, right? And so while Black academics and Black scholars and Black men professors are seen to have schools of thought, Black women are only extensions of that. And I think that's extremely telling because when we're not able to have access to our critical thought, when we're not being granted the luxury of being able to claim the very work and the scholarship that we can produce to reclaim ourselves and even these white institutions, these white institutions, these pedagogical spaces, not at all made for us, that means that we're not able to survive. And then I think also, and this is lastly, this is like on a very emotional sense, and I think also like when Black women talk about their emotions and the need to heal internally, that's also delegitimized as if it's not such a large part of the movement. And I think the myth of this strong Black woman is something that I've had to combat on within my organizing work, which has been the most traumatizing, I think, because I'm not given access to my emotions. I'm not given access to wanting to break down and protest. I'm not given access to mourning. And that in and of itself is very dehumanizing. So I think that moving forward, it has to be a multifaceted approach where we're not just fighting for the lives of Black women within the streets, but we're fighting for the lives of Black women in the academy, but we're also fighting for the lives of Black women, period. And that includes our emotional well-being. And our internal and individual well-being. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Danielle.
So I was gonna say I could speak on, I guess, personal and professional. So in media, I guess it's really hard to talk about Black girlhood because for me, I did actually 3 TED Talks. And in 2 of my TED Talks, I talked about Black girlhood. And both of those TED Talks did not make it. Because they said, because I called out basically patriarchy and I talked about intersectionality and they said it wasn't appropriate. And so it didn't make the cut. So for me personally, that's a risk. Or like times where I had to go, when Caitlyn had just came out and I was consulting with MSNBC and I started to talk about more of the Black trans women struggle, they had to take that off. They had to literally stop and cut me off the air because they said, now this is going in the wrong direction and that's inappropriate. And on a personal level, I guess, I was engaged to a top scientist who worked at a government lab in New Mexico where I was living for a while. And I experienced a lot of racism in New Mexico. I remember there was a time where me and Carissa, that's my fiance, we were talking about basically like race in America. And as we were walking into the restaurant, I guess one of the women overheard us. And it was like a group of white feminists. And she said, you know, I don't understand why black feminists think they're going to take over this movement. And so... you know. And that's where, like, I felt like it was my duty to check a couple of those women. And the unfortunate part, though, is that my fiance actually didn't appreciate that. She felt that it was inappropriate to call them out. Mm-hmm. And then, going, I guess, move forward to, we started to travel a lot. And there was a time I was in the airport, and I was standing online, and I just, like, jumped offline to grab a juice, got back online, and a white woman says to me, she says, what are you doing? And I said, what do you mean, what am I doing? I'm just getting a juice, and I'm going back online. She's like, well, you need to get to the back. And I said to her, well, I don't need to go anywhere because I was just standing here. And then she says, that's what's wrong with you niggers. And I said, that's what's wrong with who? And she said, no, that was, I had to do my 5 seconds there. And so then I ended, and my fiance is like a few feet away from me. And as the woman, like, she says, oh, you're a menace to society. And then she says, what, are you going to start protesting? And then I'm expecting my fiance at this point to at least be supportive, because I knew if I was to challenge her on her ignorance, I would be seen as the angry black woman, mm-hmm. especially in a state like Texas. Mm-hmm. And so for me, in saying all of that, is that a lot of times I feel like even when our white counterparts say that, oh, they're there for us and they're supportive and they understand our identity or that struggle, I don't think they can ever really understand it, because I personally experienced it, like, where, to me, love has no race. But when it comes to, I guess, the intersectional oppression that I face, if you can't be there to support me, then I feel like there is no love. There is no support. And so after that experience in Texas, I felt that I should go to her job and let them know that for her to be a director, she is not culturally competent or well aware of where the black people in our community. No, because she's like... She's a white woman who says, well, I have black staff, so I'm doing the work. And so I had to go to her work environment and remind them that she's not doing the work because her wife is not even support.
What happened?
And so that ended about a week after that.
You're one bad young sister.
No affirmative action just to say you like and support black women. You need to do the work when you're saying you're going to do it. And so that's the risk that I take.
One of the things that we don't talk about as often is what are the consequences of enduring all this stress, mm-hmm. long-term consequences. Mm-hmm. I have a friend who's a retired sociologist on disability, Donna Franklin, who wrote excellent book on inequality in the black family. And she was denied tenure at Chicago. Then she went back home to California, to USC. She has multiple sclerosis. And it made her begin to look at colleagues and other black women academics that she knew who were dying early. Cancer, a lot of cancer. I don't think she can prove scientifically that their environments cause their death. But it is something that does bear watching, because mm-hmm. academia is not always an easy place for anyone. Mm-hmm. And if you're under the gun, first with male colleagues feeling that you don't belong. I mean, when I taught at Hunter College here in the city for six, 7 years. And when I was up for, I came in as a full professor, but I hadn't been there long enough to get tenure. There was a good rule, I think, that we had to be observed each semester by our not only with student observations, written observations, but also by a peer. And one of my colleagues came into my classroom and said, and his report wrote, Ms. Latner looked sick and tired and like she didn't belong in the classroom. Ooh, do you know he never did that again? And it was calculated, designed to try to deny me tenure. So I went direct to the chairman's office, and I told him I wanted a conference with him and with my colleague at the same time. And I told them that first of all, we don't use personal descriptions of how one looks to determine one's worthiness as competence as a professor, but it was, and I won that case easily, hands down, because I told them, I dared them to take this observation to be considered in my tenure case. But what I'm trying to say is that if you're in a work environment where you're considered unworthy, irrespective of how competent your work is, but because of stereotypes and labels, like it's then there are day-to-day stresses. So what do you do about them, and how do you handle them, and so on. I'll stop there.
Okay.
But it's not easy.
So I'm going to get to the reward, I promise. But I think a natural segue would be to talk about something that really like fascinates and plagues and haunts me, this theme of invisibility. And so, you know, Black girls are often invisible to policymakers, to media figures, to their communities, to their parents, to their teachers, and sometimes even to themselves. And so this is a state or a status that they and we experience on a daily basis. My old, you know, not me now, but it's Black women, but I think Black girls in particular experience it more. So all of you in your work and in your lives kind of break those walls of invisibility. You're committed to shaping new stories and new narratives and confronting this kind of also an inaudibility or inability to hear and see Black girls. And I'm really fascinated, like I want to work, so maybe if there is a kind of psychologist in the room or I really want to know why, you know, if you see a group of Black girls, you know, if you see a group of Black boys, there's stereotypes about them being predatory, they're hyper-visible. When you see a group of Black girls, unless you retrained your eyes to see them, you actually just don't see them. And I just want to I don't know why this is, why we cannot see or hear Black girls unless we retrain our eyes and retrain our ears. So if you could just talk a little bit about why you think this is, and some girls are seen more than others, obviously, and what would our world look like if we could actually hear and see the contributions that these Black girls give to our country, give to their communities, and give to the world at large. So why we can't see and hear Black girls, why they too have to be retrained to see even themselves, and what looking at them and experiencing and hearing them in their fullness and vibrance, their contributions and recognizing their crisis would actually do to this great experiment of American democracy. So why don't we begin, we'll go on, Monique, Daniela, Michaela, and then Joyce?
Sure. When I talk about the invisibility of Black girls, one of the things that I like to uplift is that to be ignored is traumatic. So in many of the ways that we render Black girls invisible, we're contributing to their trauma. And so for that reason, I have tried in all of my projects to center those girls as an act of repair and as an act of social justice. We don't see Black girls often because our modern discourses, the way that we've shaped frameworks, really don't engage in a celebration of the ways in which Black girls express. So, you know, you were mentioning this sort of dichotomous way in which, you know, Black boys are hyper-visible in some ways and Black girls are rendered invisible, but
both equally.
Right, and most of how I've engaged this is examining the hypervisibility of Black girls in conditions that are oppressive. And so when we only see Black girls in pain, and we only see their expression as painful, then we are engaging in a reinforcement of the deeply harmful stereotypes that inform their access to opportunity. When I see Black girls, one of the things, you know, that I like to see is just tremendous beauty, right? And probably the most important thing that I try to communicate in every discussion about both their invisibility and their pain is that Black girls in our world, in our work, and certainly in my life, are sacred and loved. And that's something that we need to communicate over and over again. And were we to see their sacred manifestation of divine feminine energy, if we were to really engage in understanding that their presence is powerful, and the words they speak, the challenges they make, are really at the center of every major social justice movement in history in this country, then we would understand that they're a critical part of not only maintaining a commitment to democracy, but really central in the articulation of what that democracy looks like. Black women and girls have articulated it. Black girls have been at the center of these educational movements, the Brown versus Board of Education. These were Black girls. But we don't see it, right? Because we don't really talk about the fact that they were there. We kind of see images of Fannie Lou Hamer and the sick and tired. But no one ever says, okay, really, the backbone of our work, of the real engagement, the organizing, the writing, the interrogation, the systems of accountability, these were articulated by Black girls and women. And we teach that, we need to teach that to our daughters, right? And we need to teach it in our schools so that our girls see themselves as a critical part, not just in supporting men and boys in the articulation of what freedom looks like, but to understand that their presence, their being, and their words and thoughts have also shaped fundamentally our understanding of what freedom looks like.
I'm going to speak, I guess, from the trans perspective, the trans woman of color. I think oftentimes trans women of color felt invisible because there's a history of violence and a history of, I guess, transphobia that we know exists still today in society. And I think a lot of times as a trans woman of color, if you don't assimilate, as what most people would say is a Black conformist, and have the privilege also as well as passing, then a lot of times you aren't seen as a human being, you're seen as a freak. I've had many experiences where, and I'm not saying the Black women in this room, but many Black women also have said that trans women of color aren't women and definitely aren't Black women. And so I think many times it has sent trans women into hiding, feeling as if they didn't belong not only in society, but in their community, meaning in their community as a trans community, a Black women community. And so I think now we're at a revolutionary moment in terms of what it looks like of visibility and awareness for trans people. But what so many people tend to do is they look at a narrative and say that that's what a community looks like, right? And so many of us have this, I guess, perception that, oh, we can be the next Laverne, when in fact we're never probably going to be the next Laverne because a lot of us don't have the access that Laverne has. And I think now we have some more, I guess, more trans women of color want to step up and be leaders and say, this is what my identity looks like. But I don't think, and maybe I'm wrong here, but I don't think we're ever going to get to a time really where trans women of color are going to be seen fully as Black women. Because I think we have so many people in society who feels as if it starts at an anatomical identity and not us, as so many people call it, the social identity. Because I found that even my Black friends, Black women friends who say, hey, you're a woman, you're a woman, you're a woman, the moment we get in an argument, I'm the Black man, right? And it seems as if it's this built up anger that they have against black men that they think, in fact, like, I'm the problem. When I'm saying, no, I'm not a black man. I'm actually not trying to assimilate to be a black woman. What if I just want to be a woman of color and a trans woman of color, and this is what my identity looks like? And so I think now maybe it comes from, I guess, to, like, the way the incarceration and the, like, justice system works, is that when trans women are being criminalized, they're often being housed in male institutions, right? And that's a problem. Mm-hmm. And so when we have people out here, like these policymakers, and I feel like, you know, what I call our revolutionary leaders, who's not holding also their friends and their lovers accountable in terms of making sure that trans women exist as women and women of color as well. And so I think when we start to create material that says this is what a black trans woman identity looks like, and it reflects minds too, right? Like, I'm feminine the same way she is. Just because she's trans and she's, I guess, over the top femme, that doesn't mean she's not woman enough. That means maybe my womanhood looks like that, or maybe not, you know? So I feel like we're not as invisible anymore, but when will we be visible? I believe is a time when black women also join the movement of understanding that when you argue that it's black women rights and it's black rights, that you remember to have that you remember to add the trans narrative in there. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And not just for marketing reasons. Right.
And so I often, I think, interpret, like, these questions and, like, just navigate through life in a critical way through, like, the body. And I look at a lot of things through, like, a bodily paradigm, just because I'm a very, like, concrete and visual person. So, like, I think when we're combating invisibility as black women, I go back to those three images that I shared before about how we make ourselves hyper visible. And when we're not, like what you were saying earlier, when we're not welcome in spaces, force ourselves into those spaces and make ourselves visible when we were told that we're not supposed to be. But then also, there are three girls from Minnesota who were debaters and policy debaters in high school, and girls who do policy debate are dope, by the way.
That's right.
In policy debate, it's a very white dominated space. It's very like academic. There are frameworks that you have to abide by, and that does not at all allow for discussions of black women's bodies ever. And that's reflective in most of our spaces within life outside of debate as well. And so the answer to the question of why are black girls so invisible and made so invisible in the status quo, all I have to say is because the booty don't lie, right? And it's like, I think that's so telling, because when, and this was their debate argument. I'm taking inspiration from these three girls, Dua, Ion, and Tiana from Minnesota. And they're dope. You should Google them. And it's like, their argument was the booty don't lie. And when we have conversations about the booty, people have to confront truths that they didn't want to, right? And so it's like, when we are rendering black girls invisible, and when black girls are made invisible in every aspect of life, I feel like it's a way for black men, for black, for white people, for maybe black cis women, for black trans women, to not confront their own internalized oppression in the way that they are perpetuating these struggles within the status quo themselves, right? And so I think, like, another concrete image and example of that is, like, when black girls, or when girls in general, are wearing provocative clothing, right, they're told by men to put on more conservative clothing or more clothes that cover their body more, not because it's our fault that we like our bodies and our clothes, but so that they don't have to confront being sexually attracted to us, right? And so it's like, we are made invisible so that people do not have to confront their own BS, essentially.
The idea of invisibility is both simple and complex. I think that we have to begin in the home to teach our girls that they have equal value to anyone else. And that's not a new concept, because I certainly grew up with a very strong mother and aunts and grandmothers and others who told me that I was as good as anyone. And a lot of parents tried to teach that, but are later undermined by other institutions and influences. We have to create opportunities to teach parents who may lack the strong self-esteem, how to teach their girls. And we have to do that in all the institutions available to us, certainly in our churches and other religious institutions. We have to find safe spaces for girls in their clubs. We have to create organizations. We have to go into the schools as volunteers to, and I've certainly seen how difficult a job that is, but it is important for those of us who understand the problem to seek out opportunities in which to elevate the self-esteem of young girls. Back in the late 60s and early to mid 70s, there was a movement within sociology and related fields to starting with Andrew Billingsley's book, The Strengths of Black Families. And what happened for so long is that we have allowed external forces to identify what our strengths are, I mean, to not look at our strengths, but rather to impose labels such as, say, Daniel Patrick Moynihan did, and others, you know, did by looking at the family as an aberrant or disorganized institution. Our families, and what we have, in other words, we have to be advocates for girls in a very, very visible way. We have to, I mean, someone mentioned Fannie Lou Hamer, Ms. Hamer. I knew Ms. Hamer. I worked with Fannie Lou Hamer when I was in SNCC in Mississippi. And she was as strong and as positive a female influence that one could have. I was very, very, very fortunate to know Ms. Hamer and to know Ella Baker, who lived right here in Lenox Terrace. And Ms. Baker they were so different. when Ms. Hamer entered the room, she took control of it. She was a very elevating figure. She was a charismatic figure, but also with a lot of homespun wisdom and a very, very wonderful presence. That's when I was, in college in Mississippi is when I met her through SNCC and worked with her. Went with her and other members of the Freedom Democratic Party to the Democratic National Convention in Atlantic City. And we tried to get to unseat the Mississippi regular delegation that was segregated. And when the convention decided to grant our Freedom Democratic Party, was it three seats, I think, Ms. Hamer famously said, "We didn't come here for no three seats. All of us is tired." And that is a metaphor on the condition of black people, but also on black women. Let me give you another anecdote. At that same convention, several of us, those of us in SNCC were assigned, like Marion Wright Edelman, head of Children's Defense Fund, was a young lawyer then, and Marion appointed different SNCC people to accompany members of the Freedom Democratic Party to go to lobby the members of the Credentials Committee. I was assigned this great man and his wife, Hartman Turnbull, in the Delta of Mississippi. White people set his house on fire. Then the sheriff came out and locked him up for burning his own house. But he was a tough, tough man. So he and his wife and I went to see Edith Green, who's a congresswoman from Oregon, to try to get her support. And Mrs. Turnbull always carried a little brown paper bag. And she had a pistol in it. Yes. Can you imagine? No, we don't think about our strong, tough black women there, but yes. She was a reticent, little retiring figure, and she had a pistol in her brown paper bag. I thought it was so funny. What if Edith Green had known Mrs. Turbo had a pistol? She would probably have been mortified, I'm sure. But we do have... There was a school of thought called Strengths of Black Families. And what it was trying to do was to elevate that which had been stereotyped and that which had been banished and pushed out of sight. And that is to say that our families do have strengths. We have to, many need help, but we have to become their advocates. And I think that the booty don't lie.
semester, I had the honor of teaching an Intro to Afghan Lit class, and in the Reconstructing Womanhood unit, based on Hazel Carby's great book, I started with Zora Neale Hurston's Their Eyes Were Watching God, go to Sula, then The Color Purple, and ended with Janet Mock's Redefining Realness. Redefining Realness. So I started with Hurston and ended with Janet Mock.
And one of the big themes of that unit, but also of Their Eyes Are Watching God, is whether Janie finds her voice at the end of the novel, right? But this is a really important feminist trope, but like a really, really, really important Black feminist trope. And for me, it was really interesting that Janet Mock, in my interview with her and in her book, she talks about using Hurston's Their Eyes Are Watching God as a kind of framing device or a blueprint for her own coming into being narrative and memoir. So the question of voice, I think, is really important. So we talked about invisibility, we talked about inaudibility, but I would like you all, in the order of Michaela, Joyce, Monique, and then Daniela, to talk about the moment that you found this voice, this particular, and some of you may have been born with it, it had to come into its own, but the kind of coming into being, to quote Janet Mock, that you all have done, and why that's important in order to create spaces for Black girls, Black cis girls, Black trans girls, Black queer girls. Like, you literally have to find your voice and then reinvent the space and the organizations or the institutions that you're in. So if you could just talk about that moment and then a little bit about that process of finding one's voice and then reinvention of self and the spaces that you're in order to do this work, that'd be great.
So I do think that I was born with it, but I think that all of us are, right? And like, that's what's so crucial to my work. And so when I think and I talk about Sankofa, like, that's such an integral part of like my work and my organizing, because it's like all of us come from a history of resistance, being Black in America. And so it's like not something that, it's not a voice that I have to make for myself at all. It's a voice that's there, has been silenced, and I'm just turning the volume up a little bit, right? And so, like, I always talk about my mom, right, being 9 months pregnant and marching with me, like, that image of Black maternity while in the midst of, like, resisting and fighting for Black life. Like, that's always a very poignant image for me. And so I think, one, it's always just about reclaiming your voice that's already there. But then also, when you have conversations about, like, reinventing spaces, one of the pastors in Baltimore said this phrase, and it so beautifully articulates what my fight has to be. And I think so often we try to reinvent spaces that are not made for us. We try to exist in spaces that are not made for us. And while it is an amazing fight to insert yourself into those spaces, and I think that that needs to be a part of our fight, just constantly resisting spaces that are not created for us, but we also need to be creating spaces of our own, right? And so the phrase that the pastor said, and I hope it, like, you take this and say it all the time, because I do, he said, are we fighting for power or begging for privilege, right? And I think so much of our fight is begging for the privilege to exist in white spaces or male spaces or masculine spaces, but we need to be fighting for the power to create our own spaces for us.
As I was not born with a clear voice, I had all of the potential there, of course, and grew up with, as I said, surrounded by women with strong voices. But for me, finding my own voice was after I finished graduate school. I wrote a dissertation that was acceptable to my committee, based on my research on with Black girls. And then I decided I was going to do a book. But I knew I didn't want to rewrite the dissertation, because fundamentally I wrote some things in the dissertation that I didn't really believe in. I was studying, and part of the dissertation was to study adolescent, it was the intersection of race, gender, race and class on gender development. But I didn't have models around me to look to. There were no precedents on analyzing Black girls. So my finding my voice was a very torturous and painful struggle. I wrote a book. I went back to my original data. I reconceptualized a lot of what others had, discarded a lot of what others had written about. The impoverished black girl is downtrodden and she, da, da, da. And in my book, Tomorrow's Tomorrow, I discarded the scientific method. And I started out by saying that just bear with me for 1 second, because the first words, I think, were, it is difficult to determine whether this book had its beginnings when I was growing up in Mississippi, rural Mississippi, experiencing all the tensions, conflicts, joys, sorrows, warmth, compassion, and cruelty that was associated with becoming a black woman, or whether it originated with my graduate school career when I became engaged in research for a dissertation. And I'll go on to say that I'm sure that the 20 years I spent being socialized by my family and the broader black community prior to entering graduate school shaped my perception of life, defined my emotive responses to the world, and enhanced my ability to survive. And therefore, when I decided to engage in this research on what approaching womanhood meant to poor black girls, I brought with me these attitudes and values and belief and sensitivity I had to the lifestyles of the over 100 girls, adolescents I studied. And then I went on to say that I rejected the deviant perspective, and then I went on to say that, it's been so long. I quoted Kenneth Clark, who wrote his book Dark Ghetto here in Harlem. And what he said was, I could never be fully detached as a scholar or participant because more than 40 years of my life had been lived in Harlem. Started school in Harlem Public Schools. I first learned about people, love, cruelty, sacrifice, cowardice, courage, and bombast. So that I was an involved observer. And that is the perspective from which I wrote my book. It was not the detached person, but the girl who went with the adolescents to, when they set me up by going to a dance with them once, this private club. And when I showed up, dressed in my graduate school attire, thought I was dressed up in a nice little sweater and wool skirt. And they looked at me and said, no way, you're not going anywhere looking like that. So they took in the apartment, they found clothes for me to wear so that I looked like them. Then we got to the dance. First, I wanted to do everything exactly like they did in order to understand what happened. They wanted to go in my old 1960 Rambler car, and I said, no, I want to go with you guys. How do you get there? So we went out on the main thoroughfare. They started hitching a ride. I said, oh, my God. I got in the car with them. We got to the dance hall. Then they started panhandling for money to get in. And I said, oh, God. And it was only cost 50 cents. But then they turned to me and said, well, did you get your money? And I said, no. And then one girl said, you can't do anything right. I had no idea. I thought I was going to, see how they actually did things. But they had set me up so that I went. I sat down with them, and then they started dancing. And this little guy who might have come up to my shoulder came over to ask me to dance, and I said, no, I can't dance. And they said, you got to dance. So they pushed me out there, and he was grinding on me. Looking down at his head. And they're sitting there cracking up. They were hilarious. It was so funny to them. And when I got through, he wanted my phone number. And I concocted this thing, excuse that I just moved up from Arkansas. A lot of people in St. Louis were from Arkansas. And I was living with my grandmother, and she didn't allow me to receive calls. And he said, I could fix that. He said, I'll just knock on your door, and then you come downstairs. And I mean, all evening they laughed at me. Everything I did, you know, and they turned it on me. And I saw all of my own foibles and da 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 da. But if we look at the world through the eyes of our girls, I think we can really work with them in a very positive way. Mm-hmm. I never forgot that experience.
So finding my voice, I would say there's not a singular moment where I found my voice. I think it's still in development. And I am an early survivor of sexual assault and abuse. And I think that experience had a profound impact on how I saw the world from that point forward. And I became a walkout queen, right? If something didn't feel right, I was out. And it became a struggle to find the spaces that were appropriately designed and responsive to me. And it was also about, you know, a rejection of the spaces that were intentionally deemed harmful, that I could feel, I could intuit were harmful. I would vehemently reject. And ironically, I began to really find my voice at the Institute for Research in African American Studies. And at the time, having the privilege of working with Manning Marable, who understood me in a different way. He understood what I needed to fully express, to argue, who, you know, sort of celebrated my, you know, inquisitive nature, the, you know, sort of ways in which I would state things as fact, right? And challenged me to work closely with the community and to understand this relationship between the intellectual work that I was engaged in and really curious about and the community that I was so committed to. And so, you know, shortly after leaving the Institute and moving on, I wrote a street novel called Too Beautiful for Words. And in writing the street novel, you know, largely inspired by writing in the voice of the people, much like Zora, I wanted to really begin to uplift the value of voice, no matter how it's communicated, and to really have conversations with people in the voice of the people. So after, you know, sort of engaging in writing Too Beautiful for Words, I did a short piece for Essence that was titled Black Girls on Lockdown. And that was my first piece of hate mail, was after writing that that piece, where someone, a man wrote me and cursed me and said, how dare you focus on black girls when there are so many of us men in pain. And so the how dare you part was probably the moment that shifted my own consciousness to state, to fully embrace the audacity to center black girls and in everything. So after that, I wrote a book with Kemba Smith that chronicled her life as a federal prisoner and as a survivor of mandatory minimum sentencing as part of the war on drugs. Then I wrote Black Stats, and then I wrote Push Out, and who knows what else is coming, but you know it's going to center black girls. And I think it's that rejection and the, you know, sort of persistence that I feel is necessary to uplift those who others might say are not worthy of our engagement that really I find a motivator. And, you know, I think it's important. And you know, I sort of say that my process began to refine itself in college because I started reading more. I was always a reader, but I was exposed to new literature and new language and new methods and new tools. And so, you know, I feel like, you know, I remember being 9 years old and looking at a movie about Harriet Tubman, and she had a mark on her forehead, and I have a mark on my forehead, so I was like, oh, I must be Harriet Tubman reincarnated. And I had this feeling that I'm connected to her in some kind of way. And I think, you know, my connection to her at nine was really about this audacity to challenge systems of oppression. And I think we all are born with tools on how we begin to do that. And then we refine those. We refine it constantly. And so that's why I say I think, you know, there's not a singular moment where I found my voice. I think that that process is in refinement. But I am very clear that the more tools that I acquire and the longer I continue to center the population that I have chosen, or that chose me in some ways, the stronger and more natural I feel.
How did I find my voice? So I would say, for me, I guess I found my voice around age 14. And it was a time where I came out about my identity to my foster mother. I'm sorry, it makes me a little emotional every time I think about it. And it was a day where I went to school. I'm so sorry. Just 1 second. I'm so sorry. Okay. No, I'm fine. I'm sorry. It's just
okay.
I'm trying to keep my paint together.
I know. Keep your face beat, girl. Keep it beat. Make it too expensive. Okay. Not one tear. I'm sitting here like, not the foundation.
You can put more foundation.
It's okay.
No, that helped a lot. And I was attacked in school, and I got stabbed at 14. And I remember one of the administrators called home, and they said to my adopted mother, it went too far now. At that time, I was still presenting, like, I guess, as an androgynous, so they said, you need to take him out of the school. He's going to lose his life here. Mm-hmm. My adopted parents said, he chose that path, and so he's going to deal with it. Mm-hmm. And the fact that he's getting attacked, I no longer want him in my home. And so, of course, the way the system works, if you're adopted, you can't just go back in the system. So you have to stay home, and then they open up the case. And instead of waiting for ACS to come and remove me, it was about 12 o'clock in the middle of the night, and I packed a suitcase, and I threw it out of the window and tied sheets. And I jumped out of the window. And from 14 years old, when I jumped out of that window, I'm sitting here today because I never looked back. And also, I guess, another moment in my life where it was this pivotal moment where I really found my voice and had the courage to come out and start talking about these experiences is actually one of my college professors who's here today, and I struggled to come out in school. And I remember I struggled so much in school, I was literally propagating ignorance against the trans community. And I went to her one day and I said, you know, I can't do this anymore. Like, it's so hard. Like, people may speculate about my identity because, you know, there's things about me that they say aren't feminine enough, but I know my privilege as a trans woman in terms of passing. And so then she says, well, we're going to get through this together. And at that time, I was literally just finding my voice. And so with her support and Islam Nettles, who was murdered in Harlem, and across the street from a precinct, I was actually right around the corner from the gym's agency where I was doing cultural competency trainings. And I remember that moment where I said to myself, that could have been you. That could have been that moment where you were going home and someone could have catcalled you, and then you could be gone too. And so I said, you know, I realized how lucky I've been to meet people in my community who have loved me and accepted me for who I am, and has given me the tools that I needed, that I need. I mean, in order to go out there and advocate not only for myself, but for my community. And so a quote that I live by is Maya Angelou, and she says, I come as one, but I stand as 10,000. Mm-hmm. And for me, every time I go out there and I share my experiences with people, I'm reminded how I may be one Daniela, but I have tens and thousands of my ancestors behind mm-hmm. me. And I'm mindful of the fact that I am someone else's ancestor. Mm-hmm. And so what will my legacy look like mm-hmm. for them in terms of giving them someone who reflects their identity? And so my voice is my community's voice, which I live by because I'm a part of such a complex community. Mm-hmm. So.
So this will be my final question. And so I did want to also, in the spirit of sisterhood, and political solidarity, also, you know, come out as a rape survivor. It's a big part of my public work and my political work. And so, you know, for all of the disclosures that we're doing, I feel like it's important. It's usually part of my bio, but I kind of forgot to send that to Farah this morning. Okay, so this panel is obviously very intergenerational and deliberately inclusive in various ways. And so we're all in different stages and phases of our journey from Black girlhood to adulthood. And so I want us to end with a kind of, you know, retrospective. If you could, in the order of Joyce, Monique, Daniela, and then Michaela, so it's a reverse, you know, we saw what I just did there. but the question's going to seem kind of weird now. But anyway, so one, again, this idea of reward. So, you know, what's the reward of doing this work? And then two, what is something that you wish you could tell your younger self? And how has this conversation of Black girlhood, for better or for worse, changed over your lifetime? So a couple of things, like, is there a reward for doing this work, personally and professionally? What could you tell your younger self? And how has the conversation changed in your lifetime?
Good questions. For me, the rewards were intrinsic. This made me feel good about what I about the work I had done. But also, over time, my book became a classic. And that, to know that I influenced, I guess, at least two generations of budding scholars, and just ordinary people, you know, has its own rewards. I haven't been in academia since I had to go on disability with fibromyalgia in 2003. But I do try to, respond to opportunities like this. You know, I just love, I wish there was some place like that invited elders like me, scholars like me, to come in and just to share knowledge, you know? Because we have a lot of knowledge. To pass on. Maybe I'll try to get some of my president's institutions I know to do that. But having said that, the rewards, you can get rewards. You're getting rewards from knowing that you published a work, that you did a study that is having an impact on others. I really wish I had been able to do was to influence public policy makers. But if you could imagine 1971, that's been a long time ago, you know. Policies about Black girls, you know, didn't even exist unless it had to do with, you know, receiving welfare. What would I tell my younger self? To believe in yourself. Believe that. Have a can-do spirit. I had that, but I think I would say it louder. And what's the last question?
How's the conversation?
The conversation has changed tremendously. There are so many organizations now that focus on Black girls. There are so many. There are books that have been published, scholarly papers. There, the range and the expansion of what it means to be a Black girl is evidenced right here. With this was unheard of when I did my study, when people referred to gay people who dressed, cross-dressed as funny, or funny people, or had all kinds of derogatory names for them. But never an acknowledgement that they had a right to exist in their own skin, in the ways in which they define themselves and not by stereotypes imposed on them. So I am so pleased to see the conversation has just expanded exponentially.
So in many ways, I'm a child of the 70s and 80s. And I think the conversation has shifted a lot as well between then and now. And it sort of morphed in ways that provide greater opportunities for us to interrogate Black femininity and Black girl expression. And some of that's been great and some of it's been troubling, largely because of the love-hate relationship that many of us have with hip-hop culture and spaces. And so, I think for me, just having lived through much of the economic oppression and cultural oppression that has reinforced a lot of internalized absence of love, I think that there's still some work to do in our communities, but I'm encouraged by conversations like this, and I'm really encouraged to engage with younger activists and emerging scholars in this space. And every time I come across one, I get more and more excited because I see us, right? In terms of something I would, the reward is really simply, again, finding more of us. With writing Push Out, I've been able to go to several cities. And I want all the Black girls in this room to know, actually, some of the Pittsburgh crew is here. That was one of the first places I went to talk about Push Out. And since then, there were a couple hundred people in that room concerned about what was happening with Black girls. And I have been to about 7 cities this week talking about Push Out. And in every one of those cities, there have been hundreds of people gathering to talk about this issue. So I just feel that we're at a moment now where, those of us who are used to being the only one in the room to raise our hands and say, what about the girls? No, we're going to talk about the girls. Let's talk about the girls. That more and more of us are standing. That 10,000 is going to be real, real soon, right, in a room to say, not only are we each representative of the strength of 10,000, but there are 10,000 of us here representing 10,000 more each one, right? And so it's a way to, I think, really build on the momentum that's being that's been put in place. And I find that super rewarding and very exciting. In terms of what I would tell my old self, I would just tell 7-year-old me that it's not my fault. I would tell 7-year-old me that I love you. I would tell myself to stay the course and understand that every experience will shape you. Every experience will shape your relationship with your husband, with your daughters, with your mother, with the policymakers you engage, with the research you write, with the conversations you're able to have with people, with the girls you interact with in juvenile detention facilities, with the girls that you see on the street, the young women you meet in your classrooms, all of it. And so don't regret it. Embrace it and learn from it.
One of the rewards I get from doing this work is just 2 weeks ago, I should have mentioned, I ended up finding my birth family. And so 2 weeks ago, my mother and my grandmother presented me with the Roger McFarlane Youth Activist Award at Chelsea Piers. And to see 3 generations of my family present there was just mind-blowing. Another, I guess, reward that I get from doing this work, of course, you get to meet some super cool people. And then, of course, this opportunity here. I would have never imagined being here. And then I think with the media platform, I'm really happy. I guess I should talk about one of the projects I'm working on is I'm collaborating with YouTube and PBS on starting a short doc series on trans youth and early childhood, like transition. And so that's a huge reward. And knowing that I've been very lucky to get access to medically transition, I guess I'm really happy that my global foundation has been providing medical, sponsorship for trans youth all across the world. So that's a plus, I guess. Because I say it that way only because I feel like it shouldn't have to be that way. Like, we shouldn't have to start foundations that's supporting trans people medically. But if someone has to do the work, I guess I'm honored to do the work. So
your younger self.
Oh, and then my younger self. What would I tell my younger self? That don't just tell yourself that it's going to get better. Know that it's going to get better. Because every day that you chose to wake up and continue to live, you were creating a legacy not for yourself, but for so many other people who want to give up. And you remind them not to give up.
Okay, so I think like I'll start with like how this conversation has shifted a lot, and I think that was really kind of reflective in my previous answers. But I respect that this movement is now so like it's so disrespectful, right? And it's not about respectability politics, and it's so open and unapologetic. And I love the movement to reclaim our bodies. I think like as a first. As a first step, as a prerequisite to all of our other movements, my ability to claim the husk that my soul lives in is so empowering, right? And so, like, twerking at protest, twerking, like, while I'm in handcuffs because I just got arrested at a protest, twerking before I debate the police commissioner of my city, like, that is beautiful, right? Black girls, and twerking is my thing, so I'm trying to twerk. But like,
it was a demonstration.
Maybe. But like, the ability to reclaim our bodies and still be legitimate and still be valid and still be affirmed and still be woman and still be human is beautiful, right? And so like that shift in paradigm to like not only have protest for our blackness, but protest for our womanhood and its true essence and its authenticity and however that manifests itself, protest for our fluidity as women, that's beautiful. And then, like, the reward of that, I think, is the power that comes along with it, right? And I think power is what we need to be fighting for. And, like, autonomy, bodily autonomy, autonomy within politics, activating our political agency, having voice within every space that we engage in, that's an obvious reward. Of course, the community is a reward. Having black girls to support you around the country is something, is a blessing that I don't think many people get to experience. But I have been granted the opportunity to sit on panels like these, and that's such an amazing honor. But then also as, like, wholly the humanity of it all, the fact that I am able to create spaces of humanity for myself, the fact that I am able to be invited to spaces of humanity, of humanizing black girls like this, is amazing. And then what I would tell to my younger self is a weird question because it's like I am my young self. But I think like also like that fact, the fact that I am my young self, it like contributes to the like the true dynamic of that question where it's like we are all currently our younger selves when we look into the future. And so it's like we are always having to tell ourselves messages and like always having to teach ourselves things that we have to learn for our future. But I think one thing that I'm still trying to combat is that I always apologize for my greatness. And I think, like, and, like, this is not something that it's, like, oh, I'm about to do it right now. I was about to do it. But it's, like, we as amazing black young women always say, I'm sorry for being confident. I'm sorry for knowing I'm lit. I'm sorry for knowing. Right? And it's, like, but we are. Right? And it's so easy to say that. It's so easy to say that, but it's so hard to practice it, right? And that manifests itself in very real ways in our lives, right? So in our relationships, if we don't act like we're great and we don't act like we know that we deserve better, we settle for less. And that happens within policy. That happens in our job space, in our workspaces. And so that statement in and of itself is so empowering. But also, like, passing on not only the message of Sankofa, but also Ubuntu, which is I am because we are. And I need black girls to love each other. There's so much drama that is projected as, like, who we are as a community. And it's like, this is what blackness, black girls look like when we are together, right? And it's great and it's magnificent. And so I take pride and I'm comfortable saying that I am great because I know that when I'm saying I am great, I'm saying we are. And so that is what makes me so comfortable in being so unapologetically black and woman.
Yes.
I just wanted to add one thing, and that is that over these 50 years, I have seen a tremendous
increase in the role of fathers in projecting their girls and taking a great interest in their girls' welfare. I think some, and also with Title IX, the young girls being able to participate equally in athletics and so on. I just know so many fathers who would have said that, well, I want my son to be a doctor or whatever. Now they're saying I want my daughter to be a doctor. Mm-hmm. I think it's the passage of generations where men have come to, well, the society has stressed equality of sexes for quite a while now, and therefore fathers are also, it's also a comfort level. I mean, in the old days, fathers were remote and, you know, not remote, but they stuck with their boys, you know, and they pushed their boys. My son is going to be thus and so. I have friends who are physicians, and now they're not saying, I want my boy to be a doctor, but my girl's going to be a doctor, you know, whatever. And I think that's a big, big change.
Thank you. So we're going to end now. I just want to say what I would tell my younger self. I was asked this recently at a Source performance, Story of Rape Survivor, performance that my sister created. In honor, but also to explore my recovery from sexual assault. And it's similar to what you said, I think, of, you know, what would you tell your younger self is like, it gets better, you'll get through this, and through community and through coalition. But recently, as Kira, one of the conference co-organizers, kind of asked of us and suggested we do, is put these pictures of ourselves online, like, you know, childhood pictures of us as little girls. And I was looking at these pictures and I was thinking, like, why did I ever think I wasn't beautiful, powerful, smart? You know, I was looking at that, what all that stuff, whether it's, if it's adolescence or tween years, and to feel who I am now and the kind of fullness, even though I'm still, you know, wrestling with these things. I just want to tell that little girl, like, I wish she could feel what I feel now, the fullness and the boldness. And that comes from all of you, and it comes from you. And so just thank you all for being so open, so thoughtful, and so engaging on this panel. I think we set a good bar for panelists after us, a high bar. So thank you all. Thank you.
What a wonderful start. So we're going to ask you to go out.